Say we want to stop these cancer cells, reproducing themselves.
Mm-hmm.
So we have a disease, so we have a purpose, that's great, and we have a target, right? So there are a couple ways we can do this. Usually people do it all together. So you should start definitely with literature, know what's out there, know what people are doing. And you can take those molecules already into account for your search, for your next step.
You, meaning others have tried to inhibit specific enzymes or...
Right.
Okay, yeah.
So you can do that. You also have... A lot of enzymes have a certain percentage of similarity. So you can look into similar enzymes that have been, widely studied. Like polymerases for cancer, you have so many, right? Mm-hmm. And they always have a certain percentage of identity. So that's one. The second one, we can, let's say that, we know someone that started a company and they actually were going for another treatments, and they actually saw that their enzyme, actually targets one of these polymerases. So that's another one, right? We just use these unexpected results from other companies that are actually, not going to work on it.
You have this molecule that you wanted to do something, and then you find out it does this other thing. Well, then you just run with that and see what you can do with that.
Right. Or you see why is this molecule actually doing this, where we thought it was actually going to do something completely opposite. Then, the other option, which is very used nowadays, is the high-throughput screening, right? So we have a chemical library, and we just screen thousands and thousands of compounds for the target that we are looking for. And so then we get hits, and we choose, our thresholds and our values, and then we analyze those molecules. So let's say that we start with that.
Actually, before we go, I want to really understand. So are we talking like in vitro, like a bioassay? Mm-hmm. Is that, or we can also do like simulations too, right?
Right. So, all of that comes kind of together, I'd say. But let's say we start with screening, right?
Okay.
And then from those, that library of like 10,000 or 20,000 compounds, you can have anything from like 10,000 to 100,000, right?
Mm-hmm. And these are small molecules, a couple dozen atoms or so.
Yeah, small molecules. Yeah. And, this bioassay is actually looking to our target, the one we want. So let's say out of that, we get like 250 results, right? Mm-hmm. So, here also varies a lot if you work in academia, if you work in industry, or if you and I are starting a company for our cancer research, how much money we have. So, it's going to vary a lot of things. But let's say from those 250 compounds, we are going to analyze them, some of them manually. We are going to see what do they have in common. We might be able to use some softwares that actually, do this for you. But let's say, in the lab, you do it manually.
Right.
You look at them, you see what they have in common, right? Mm-hmm. And then you start cutting, or you start seeing, okay, this part of the molecule is the same for everything, so let's just go with that, right? So we're able to, from 250, get it down. And then from there, you start the computational analysis, right? So
it's you're in the lab first. What
it varies.
It varies.
Usually a cycle, right? Mm-hmm. So you have some molecules in mind that you find through whatever path you found them.
And what are you physically doing? You need some biological material, right? You need some cells. How does the bioassay work? I don't even know.
I'm asking. So that kind of comes later, but the high throughput screening is a very robotic. Assay. They do have their own assay, of course, and usually it just comes with some sensors, right, like fluorescent and things that give you...
You're just looking for properties of the molecule.
You just look for, like, binding affinities for the molecule to that target.
Oh, to that. Okay, got
to
it.
To that target.
Got it. So we're just looking at how this interacts with the enzyme.
That's right.
Okay.
So, usually, let's say, the less color you get, the fluorescent you get, then biggest affinity. Or it does vary on the acid, though.
Less fluorescent. Okay, so the...
It varies.
Okay, yeah, everyone has a difference, right?
But, so it's going to vary,
it has some property, but then when it binds, it does less of it, so...
Right.
We can see
you can measure
binds,
right?
And so then all of these, you say, okay, there's 250, and then like these 10 were the best, and they all have a carboxyl group right here or something, so that's a really important feature, or something.
Yes,
like
so
that.
Then you see that one has a ring, or that one has like a three ring. So you kind of analyze them and combine them into, you know, types of molecules, let's say.
Okay.
Right? So let's say we have one with three rings that is aromatic, the other one is just a linear molecule, and then the other one, you know, whatever we can come up with, like that we see. So then here is when you start. You can either go to the lab and start synthesizing, and here is when the cycle starts. So let's say there is one that we really think that's it, right? Mm-hmm. So we're going to go to the lab. We're going to make these molecules, right? It's like a puzzle.
Yeah,
right?
And we're going to talk a lot about that.
Right, so later. We're going to put pieces together, and we're going to get these molecules at the end. So the potion making. Mm-hmm. I had some friends there used to, you know, call me a potion maker. So, so you have that, and then if you do these bioassays, and that's, you know, you have to collaborate with biology. So if I'm a chemist by training, I'm usually not doing these assays, but we have collaborators, right? And so those assays, they come, you know, with pharmacokinetics, pharmacodynamics, you know, all those properties that we need to look at. Mm-hmm. So you look at that and you see, okay, this is good values, but it could be better.
Okay, right? Better binding,
better potency, you know, better outcome, pretty much, between the target and the molecule. Mm-hmm. So once we have those numbers, what we have to do is something called structure-activity relationship, which means you keep improving and changing your molecule so that you try to optimize your outcome. Mm-hmm.
Right? Move a carbon over here, turn this carbon into an oxygen, just slightly... toy with is that where the computer comes into play? Or
so yes, the computer helps here a lot, because once you are able to actually get like a crystallography structure of your molecule with the protein or, you know, the enzyme, then you look at it in the computer and you actually see pretty close to reality.
Right.
You know, so we assume.
That's fascinating. So you've got the enzyme, and you know the primary structure, and you've got the active site, and then you take your little molecule and you just plop it right in there.
Right.
And then you see, oh, like this interaction is happening here, this interaction. Mm-hmm. And then do you then hypothesize as to how the inhibition is occurring, like whether there's a covalent linkage, like a serine, like it attacks right here, and then that ruins the enzyme and that kind of a thing. Okay.
Yeah. So you look at it and you see, okay, so if this part of the molecule is completely inside the pocket, then it means it's very important, right? So we need to optimize this part of the molecule and just make these bonds stronger.
Okay. Right?
So then if you look at those amino acids in the protein around, then you can say, oh, you know, if we add like carboxylic group here, then we can have a hydrogen bonding with that amino acid.
And even stronger. Yeah, these are the interactions that are probably happening. So if we make these changes and we don't impact the general shape of the molecule, but we just add a change to a particular atom that will make a stronger interaction, that should help.
And you can actually look at like distance, right? So you see, this group here just needs to be a little bit longer so that it actually sits in that perfect spot. Mm-hmm. Then you just go back to your molecule and do that, right?
Just insert a carbon in that.
Just click a button and the carbon is there.
Right.